Y'all can grab a seat for me real fast. Well, I was in college when I went through my first ever real-life, real-world business interview. Now, I was a sophomore, just haphazardly scrolling through the career page in my dorm, and as I was doing so, I was just dropping my resume into every attractive company that I could think of. I had really no rhyme or reason about it. If I knew the name, I put a resume in, and so here I am, just in my dorm, walking through the career page, submitting resume after resume after resume, and then eventually, to my unexpected surprise, I got this email response that I had been accepted for an interview by none other than Goldman Sachs. I was a sophomore, and so this really jazzed me up. I was really excited about the prospect of going and interning with a company quite like Goldman Sachs 55 and the Fortune 100, and so I decided to hop on Google and start training up on interviews. I'd never been through one before, and so I get on Google and I start learning all the proper interview etiquette, and I call up a buddy because I don't own a suit, but he does, and maybe he can lend it to me, so I take his suit, and I get ready, and I show up the day of the big interview. I make my way to the business office, and I grab a seat in their foyer, and about after 15 minutes or so, the recruiter comes outside of the door, and he invites me inside. I walk in, I sit down in the office with him, and he begins to walk me through a list of behavioral interview questions. Things like, what are your strengths and weaknesses, and tell me about a time you solved a problem, and what you learned from it, what are the values that you think are important to have on a team. Everything that Google had told me to prepare for, I was absolutely acing it. It felt amazing. I was not sure what to expect walking into this interview, but I definitely didn't expect it to be this easy. That is until the second part of the interview started. Because he leaves the room and then walks in, not a recruiter from Goldman Sachs, but an actual Goldman financier. And he begins the technical portion of the interview, which made sense because he was a financial analyst there to interview me for a financial analyst internship. Only I had never taken a financial class in my life. And so the next 30 minutes of interview consist of me just trying to pull the wool over this guy and throw out every financial term I can possibly think of in the moment, or at least whatever sounds like a financial term. And so I'm throwing out cost-benefit analysis, this and asset liquidation, this and Pythagorean theorem. I don't know. It sounds convincing. And so I launch it out there into the middle of the conversation, and then the interview ends. He lets me leave. And I'm just begging God, praying, Lord, please let him not have found me out. Do you think I got the internship? No, of course I didn't. Like, it takes way more than just a really attractive resume and a great first impression to land a job with a company like Goldman Sachs. No, what they wanted is they wanted basic skills needed so that I could succeed in a working relationship with them. The same is true in dating relationships. There's a set of basic skills we need so that way we can succeed, not in working relationships, but romantic relationships with a significant other, with someone of the opposite sex. It takes way more than just having a high-quality dating resume and a good first impression to land a significant other for any dramatic length of time. It takes way more than just that. And so over the course of the last two meetings, last week and this week, we've been walking through a list of do's and don'ts on dating, that there are guiding principles according to God's word that we can learn, that can inform us on how we should navigate the tumultuous waters of relationships. Last week, we worked through the first four, the do's and don'ts of dating. Number one, don't be anxious, do be dependent. We talked about it last week. Trust God with your life. Don't depend on a guy or a girl to bring you the kind of satisfaction and meaningful connection that you're longing for. Jesus lived the most meaningful life imaginable, and he did not depend on anyone for it other than God. So you be dependent. Number two, don't be passive, do be purposeful. That when we step into relationships, there's a purpose with it. We're not aimless, we're intentional. We have an actual end in mind, that we're dating over the course of a process to reach the end, which is eventually marriage. The third, don't be confusing, do be clear. Like, you want to say what you mean, and you want to do so that way they know where they stand. You want to make sure that you're communicating in such a way that doesn't leave them in the dark, but sheds light on what is the status of our relationship. Where is it that you stand with respect to me? What's true of us today? And then the fourth was, don't be dramatic, but do be steady. The world is crazy enough as it is. So don't link up with someone that is crazy. No, you find someone that's steady and you engage the crazy together. That's where we were last week. If you didn't catch it with us, go listen to it because these are points that I think will be helpful. But tonight, we're diving straight into the next four. So the first of which is this, that if you want to know what to do and not do in dating, then number one, don't be isolated, do be inclusive. Don't be isolated, do be inclusive. You see, dating is not a static commitment, it's not a static state of commitment, but it is a dynamic process of assessment. That's what you engage in whenever you step into dating. That as you date, you're appraising two things within the life of another person. You're appraising the quality of their character. Are you someone that's full of integrity, uprightness, godliness that I would want to fasten myself alongside? And then number two, you're appraising them for chemistry. Like you're wanting to assess the quality of their chemistry with you. That's not the most important thing, but it is something to consider. That if you are of high character, then I need to know, do we align on the things that matter most in life? Do we align in our beliefs, in our faith, in our morals, in our mission, in the plans for our future? Do we align in these areas? You're appraising character and chemistry whenever you step into a dating relationship. This is what happens. But here's the thing. Too often, we do this all by ourselves. We work through this assessment period on our own. We isolate away from other people, and we try to figure it out by ourselves. But here's the thing. If you study the Bible, what you realize is this is not the Bible's prescribed method for evaluating the character of someone else and the chemistry between two different people. This is actually, in the Bible, it's not the ancient Near Eastern way at all that people would approach marriage. You see, in the Bible, 2,000 plus years ago, what you find is that people, they would have arranged marriages where they didn't follow our traditional Western model of courtship where they see someone they like, they get to know them, and then eventually they introduce them to their community. No, instead, their community would find somebody that, man, they look great, we're gonna pick them for you as a spouse, and therefore then you will marry them. This was the model in the scriptures. And now I'm not standing here today trying to defend the merits of arranged marriages, like Eastern-style weddings over Western-style weddings. I'm not trying to defend the merits of either. They both have their own flaws. But here's what I am saying. The Bible makes very clear that there is safety in the context of community. This is what it's saying. It says in Proverbs 11:14, where there is no guidance, a people falls, but in an abundance of counselors, there is safety. Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, plans fail. But with many advisors, they succeed. What's the point? The point is this, that isolation makes for really poor evaluation. Isolation makes for poor evaluation. That stepping into a relationship should not mean that you are stepping away from your community. In the medieval age, the Anglican Church, in the Book of Common Prayer, they liturgize a really famous oral tradition that every one of us knows from Western weddings. Speak now, or forever hold your peace. Why did they write that into their liturgy? Because this was the method by which they would protect those whom they loved that were standing at the altar with someone they may or may not well know. This was how they ensured that the person they loved who was getting married was not being forcefully coerced into holy matrimony. This was their method of protecting their community. Now, we don't do this today, but we do the same anyways. What we do is we know that the more community we include into our lives, the more safety we invite into our lives. That we don't want to date isolated from the watching world, but we want to do it in front of our friends and our family and the people that we trust. You see, other people, they can see things that you can't. They can identify blind spots. They can get vantage on something that you may not actually look for or think to see. This is what we see in 1 Corinthians 4:4, that it's not always necessarily we're not necessarily trying to be blind to it, but we can be. It says from the Apostle Paul, my conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It's the Lord who judges me. Like Paul's saying here, man, I've done my best. My conscience is clear. I have no ill intent, and yet that doesn't make me innocent. You see, here's the thing. Why is community so important in the context of relationships? Because when you step into a dating relationship, most people, they try to conceal any cause for concern. That's what we always talk about. Put your best foot forward, which isn't bad advice, and yet it's universally true for most everybody in a relationship that most people, they are going to try to put their best foot forward and conceal the concerning parts of them from you. And so what you need is you need different people that have different perspectives on you and your relationship. People that can look at that guy and assess the way that he interacts with people who he's not romantically inclined in. People that can look at that girl and say, what is the content of her speech? Does she trust the Lord with her life? That's what you want friends and community to come into your life and assist you with. I remember early in my relationship with Brooke, when we were first dating on, one of my best friends, he looked at me and he was like, man, can I third wheel with you guys? I don't know Brooke, but I really want to get to know her. Can I go on the next date with you guys? Totally. Well, what is it? We're going to go see the movie Frozen, and we're going to wear flannels. He was so pumped for it. Not because of the combination of Frozen and flannels, but because he was really excited to get to know Brooke. Because he was really interested in learning this girl that had swept me off of my feet. He didn't just want to see who she was. He wanted to see who we were. He wanted to get good perspective on us. And I was so thrilled that he wanted to come. And here's the thing, Brooke was too. She was excited that he tagged along. I think they had more fun than we did that night. And in it, it affirmed to me the kind of character that I knew to be true of her. That she's somebody that didn't have anything to hide. She wasn't trying to conceal different parts of herself from me or from those that cared about me. No, it was important for Brooke and I very early on, and I want it to be important for you too, that you don't just date in the context of community. We hear that language thrown around all the time, but we don't want to just date in the context of community. We want to date inclusive of community. You get what I'm saying there? Like, it's more than just, we've got our friends around us. No, it's our friends are invested in us. They're involved in the process that we're undergoing together. That's what you want to be true. You want to have people that are totally committed to helping you get clarification on if they are, in fact, who they are presenting themselves to be. But here's an important clarification. As you think about, okay, I need to bring community into my relationship. Like, as you think about that, community, it doesn't merely consist of good friends. Community consists of godly guides. What do I mean by that? What I'm saying is that guides give really good direction, while friends make really good company. Your community will consist of friends, but it should not solely consist of friends. There should be people in your life, godly guides, that have both wisdom to offer and love to act in your best interest. So what makes a godly guide? Two things. I just told you the first. You need people that are wise and loving. They won't just tell you what you want to hear, but will tell you what you need to hear. People that are wise enough to know what to look for and trusting enough, loving enough to actually take action on it, to tell you what you need to hear. You see, you need people in your community that you trust with more than just a voice into your relationship, but people that you trust with a vote into your relationship. What do I mean by that? You want people that are so wise and so loving that as they speak into your world, you've empowered them to help chart the course of what happens between the two of you. That if they look at you and they say, hey, I've got cause for concern, this relationship is really toxic, that isn't just something you hear as advice. Instead, it's something you heed as good direction. Now, their vote is equal to your vote, but if the majority of your community is voting against your preference, then wisdom would say and love would say you should listen. And it's not just in the context of, man, maybe I need to split off from this person. Like, it's not just that. Maybe it's in the context of stepping into that relationship with that person. Maybe your community is looking at you and being like, man, but this girl, this guy, they're really great. Like, we know them. We've spent time with them. I've got a great friend today. I can't wait. We're celebrating their wedding in just a couple of weeks. He was on the fence about this girl that his community kept recommending to him. And eventually he was like, fine, let's do it. I'll go for it. Wouldn't you know it, they're engaged. Like, his community knew him so well and knew her so well that when he finally submitted to what they were voting for, it worked itself out. Now, that's not a promise for every single time, and yet the point still remains. If they're wise and they're loving, you can trust them. That's the first thing you're looking for. The second thing is you want people that have walked with God longer than they've walked with you. You want people that are so committed to God that as you look at them, the landscape of their life, all of the history points to the fact that they will walk with him forever. Now, this doesn't mean that they're always going to be older than you, but it oftentimes will mean that they're older than you. Like, if you go and you read the Apostle Paul as he writes out his letter to Titus, what he says is, he says, hey, older men and older women find younger men and younger women to invest in, to train up in godliness, to show the way that you should walk with your Lord. We should look for older people that can be a part of our community. But I don't know how to look for someone that's older than me. Open your eyes and identify the person that looks most godly in the room to you. Men, you find the godliest husband you can. Women, you find the godliest wife you can. And then you humbly approach them. You ask them to lunch. You prepare questions to make good use of the time. And you build a friendship. I'm speaking from experience. Will this work every single time? No, but it's still worth something pursuing. And the best way to find people to invest in you is to get involved in something, to serve in your church, to volunteer with a ministry, to find people that you get a good observation of. That way, when you approach them, they don't just know you from Adam, but they've seen you around the block, and they feel inclined to go and grab lunch. You find people that have walked with God longer than you. And see, here's the cool thing. As you bring community into your relationship, they're going to demonstrate to you how the two of you should interact with each other. Which brings us to our second principle, that you don't be critical, you do be kind. Don't be critical, do be kind. Which feels obvious. Like, how many of you would have guessed? Like, kindness is necessary for a relationship. Everyone, if they were writing it out, would probably arrive at the conclusion, I should be nice to the person. Like, this is not something that feels totally outside of this world. And yet, here's the thing. I sit and I counsel people in relationship often. And what I find is so often, the conflict is the product of people that assume the worst, meaning they're critical, rather than believing the best, meaning they're kind. This feels obvious, and yet it's not as easy to find as we think. If it were, then the New Testament would not be filled with these one another statements that the authors have just felt so compelled, so inspired to write out and advise us on how we should interact with each other. There are over 50 one another statements in the scriptures. Scriptures that set both priority and precedent on how we should engage with one another in relationship. Not just romantic relationships, but general relationships. We ain't got time to go through all 50 plus. But if you look at them, you see that they actually fall into four very neat categories. And they all share one common attribute: kindness. The one another statements of the scriptures are all rooted in this attribute, which should be characteristically true of our dating. And it's kindness. So we'll walk through the four real fast. The first one is that kindness is peaceable. Kindness is peaceable. Over a third of the one another statements, more than 33% of the one another statements in your Bible, they talk about being peaceable with one another, bearing with one another, seeking unity with one another, that this is what it means to be kind, that we fight for us. 2 Corinthians 13:11, finally, brothers, rejoice. Aim for restoration. Comfort one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Ephesians 4:32, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. There are many more, but just with those two in mind, it helps us to realize, man, if we're having to bear with one another and preserve the bond of peace, the implication is that we are bound for conflict at some point, which makes sense. Because when you get in close emotional proximity with another person, particularly in romantic relationships, conflict is going to incur. Like, you're going to say something you didn't mean, or you're going to forget something you should have remembered. This happens all the time. Listen, guys, women are sophisticated by design, and you are not. They have layers upon layers upon layers to peel back and understand, and you are rather much more simple. I'm speaking as one of you. This is the story for me in my marriage with my own wife. And so listen, you're going to say something that you didn't intend to upset her with, but regardless still will. You'll forget something that you should have heard that will ultimately leave her brewing with frustration. What do you do in that moment? You listen very carefully. You speak very patiently. And you take responsibility wherever you can. This is what it looks like to move through a conflict in a dating relationship for the men. For the ladies, you need to know this, that oftentimes we don't know what you're thinking. That you're bent out of shape over something and we're not sure what it is. We've worked hard to try to walk back the steps that eventually led to the conflict, but we can't arrive at the conclusion. We don't know how we ended up here. And so you be gracious, and you re-explain what happened, and you re-explain it again, and you make sure he's able to follow along. And then here's what you do. You do not postulate about some deficiency in his character. You conversate about what went wrong with his behavior that led to the feelings that you now have. This is what it means. You don't assume the worst. Don't be critical. You believe the best. You be kind. Second category, kindness is devoted. It's devoted. This makes up another third of the one another statement. So we're at 66% now at this point. This one, devotion, it's this idea of loving someone else, being faithful to someone else. So first, you preserve the bond of peace. You fight to maintain an us. And then you seek to love and be faithful to someone else. John 13:34, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I've loved you, you also are to love one another. 1 Peter 4:8, above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Godly devotion is not, it is not commitment averse. Like, godly devotion doesn't have commitment issues, but we do as a generation. We see all the time through the research and in our own personal lives that too often we're in the business of stringing other people along, dating but keeping our options open, making sure that, man, I don't want to commit to one, so I'm going to date multiple people all at once. This is what's so intrinsically true of our generation based upon what the researchers are saying. We're not prone to commitment. We're not naturally drawn towards faithful devotion. And yet what we see right here is that kindness is devoted. It's full of faithfulness and fidelity. Like, it behaves in a way that allays any cause for concern about the level of my commitment for you. This may sound silly. I remember when Brooke and I first started dating, I made a personal commitment that I was not going to like any other girl's photos on Instagram. Which was really silly at the time. I look back and I'm like, man, that was probably too much. And yet, I wanted so badly just to ensure that she had no cause for concern or question about the level of my commitment to her. I wanted to prove I'm faithful. You can trust me. And I want the same for you. Kindness is devoted. Thirdly, kindness is encouraging. This composes about 18 to 20% of the one another statement. So we're getting towards the end of it. We're upwards about 88 to 90% at this point. And what you find is that kindness, it's encouraging, it's edifying, it's building someone up. Hebrews 10:24-25 says, and let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. You see, this word, to encourage, it literally means to put courage into someone else. This is what you want. You want to find someone that'll catch a grenade for you. You know, like that's the kind of courage that your love should inspire. It should lead someone to take up courage and put themselves out there for the benefit of the one they love. If you're in a relationship that leaves you consistently insecure, that constantly stirs up self-consciousness about the way you look or the things you say or how you behave, that's worth reconsidering. Ladies, if you're in a relationship where you don't hear from your boyfriend, you don't hear from your significant other, the guy that you're dating, if you don't hear from him that he cares about both who you are mentally, who you are emotionally, and who you are physically, and insecurity is drummed up as a result, you should hit the road. You should get out. Men, if you're in a relationship where it feels like you're never good enough, where you're the subject of constant complaining, the object of her every frustration, then that is cause to reconsider things. Because kindness, it's encouraging. It doesn't tear people down. It builds them up. You don't want to be in a relationship that feels prone towards nagging and neglect. You want to be in a relationship that's marked by encouragement. And let me just say, kindness, it is true at the beginning of a relationship, and it is true at the end of a relationship. Kindness is encouraging even in a breakup. We're going to talk about this more in the Q&A if you want to join us for it, but here's what you need to know. It is possible in a breakup to be honest and yet gracious as the relationship dissolves. And so men, do not tell her you're breaking up with her because you're not attracted to her. That's not kind. That's really rather cruel. Now, I'm not telling you to be dishonest, but I am telling you, speak things that are helpful, that are actually within her power to control. Ladies, you don't dismiss him because, well, he's not my type. He's not really what I was thinking. He's not exactly what I had planned for my future. You don't just dismiss him so frivolously. No, you be gracious with him. This is what kindness does. It encourages even to the end of the relationship. It edifies, and it leaves people better than we found them. Last one, fourth and finally, kindness is humble. This is the last like 15% or so of the one another statements. It's humble. Another way of thinking about it is it's hospitable. It takes of its resources, and it deploys them in service to the other. Galatians 5:13, for you are called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. Philippians 2:3-4, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others or one another more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Put simply, your relationship, it should be marked by humility and servant-heartedness. This is why it makes so much sense to serve in your church, to get plugged into a ministry, because that's a great place to find people. Now, I'm not telling you to serve so that way you find a relationship. No, you serve because you care and you're compelled by the cause of what that ministry exists to do. And yet what you'll find as you get plugged in is you're surrounded by people that are both sensitive to the mission of God and so selfless they can actually achieve it. Isn't that what you want? Like, we're very intentional here at Metro to call the members of our ministry volunteers. There's a variety of ministries that say their people are ambassadors or leaders or representatives, and those are all fine titles, but we think intrinsic of the title volunteer is someone that embraces humility, that willingly gives of themselves for the benefit of other people without any recognition or reward. This is what we want. Why? Because Jesus Christ voluntarily gave of himself. He gave everything he had for our benefit. He was totally humble. Full of servant-heartedness. We want that to be true here, but I want that to be true for you. You have a relationship that is kind in that it's humble towards each other, that it serves one another, it seeks the welfare of the other. Because if you're in a relationship where that's not the case, where they won't do that for other people, then they certainly won't do it for you. Which brings us to our third do and don't of dating. Don't be naive, but do be vigilant. Don't be naive, but do be vigilant. If you've been around the church for any amount of time, then you know there's this pretty traditional popular narrative that young adults and sex is like perpetually on the rise. Like hookup culture has never been higher. That casual sex is up and to the right forever and always. Like this is the common narrative whenever you walk into the church and you hear them talk about young adults and the topic of sexual interaction. And it's interesting. This week, I was looking at the Billboard Top 100. 8 out of the 10 top 10 songs involve themes of sexual deviancy and romantic entanglement. Like this is not just the popular narrative in the church. This is the popular narrative amongst mainstream media. And yet here's what's so fascinating. If you go and you do the research, and you look over the course of the last 5 to 10 years, the opposite is actually true of our generation. Jean Twenge, she said it like this. She's a psychology professor at San Diego State University, and she's one of the foremost experts on Gen Z. She said that people in their 20s are 2.5 times likely, 2.5 times as likely to be abstinent as their parents were at their age. They are 2.5 times as likely to be abstinent as their parents were at their age. Now, listen, we're not a room full of 20-year-olds. We're not all a part of Generation Z, and yet what we know to be true about this data set speaks volumes for the conclusions that researchers are reaching about you and I. They're saying that our generation is one that is in the middle of a sex recession, where sex is on the decline. It's actually not on the up and up. That we're not as prone to casually hook up with strangers. And yet here's what's also interesting. Pew Research, they would report that 72% of young adults believe sex is acceptable in a committed relationship. 72%, that's 3/4 of people see that sex is acceptable in a committed relationship. How do we make sense of the different data points? It would say this, that we are less likely to engage in casual sex with strangers, but we are just as likely as always, if not more so likely, to engage in committed sex within the confines of a relationship. This is why we must be vigilant. You see, if you look at the usage of pornography since 2020, research shows that dramatic increases are true for both men and women in overall consumption. So here's the big takeaway. How do you make sense of all of it? The big takeaway is this. The sex recession is not a lust recession. We are just as capable as past generations of curbing our sexual appetites as humanity has always been. We are willing to indulge them as much as we always have. And a dating relationship, a committed, confined commitment, is a likely place where we'll search for it. Now, that feels heavy, but let me just say, sex is not bad. It's actually rather amazing. It's a pretty beautiful thing. It's incredibly powerful. God made it, and if you think about it, it's actually the vehicle through which human life is created. It has that kind of power trapped up in it. That's amazing to think about, but it's also why sex outside of God's design is really damaging, and it's extremely dangerous. See, too often we look up to heaven and we say, man, God just doesn't want me to have a good time. But that's just not the case. He loves you and he's trying to protect you. That's why he says in Proverbs 6:32, he who commits adultery lacks sense because he who does it destroys himself. That doesn't sound punitive. That sounds protective. 1 Corinthians 6:18, flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits, it's outside the body. But the sexually immoral person sins against his own body. Sexual compromise outside of God's design, it's dangerous. So let me just implore you, do not do it. Be vigilant. You be like Aladdin in the Cave of Wonders. As you're in a sea of tempting jewels, you have eyes to seek only the lamp. You move towards that which is most precious of all, taking nothing else with you, which is purity. That's what you do. You move towards it because it will protect you until you're able to enjoy something so good in the right way. Paul says in Romans, make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires, meaning you don't need to invite unnecessary temptation into your relationship. No, you be really intentional about building appropriate boundaries. What do those look like? Well, I guarantee you, it doesn't look like staying up late at night with the person you love. It doesn't look like locking yourself behind their bedroom door because nothing good happens in that environment. It doesn't look like going on trips with just them and you alone where it just costs too much to pick up a couple of different rooms so we'll stay in the same place. No, you're inviting temptation unnecessarily. You're making provision for the flesh. Man, Brooke and I, we had this commitment because when I would drop her off at the end of the night, it always felt tempting to just linger in our car. And when we pulled in, it was like, get out. You're not safe here. Like, get out of my car. I'll see you tomorrow. Like, we never feel like when that moment strikes, we're like, oh my gosh, like, no, stay with me. And it's like, no, please go. I will see you in the morning. We will talk tomorrow. Like, this is the way that we interact with the topic of sex. We make no provision for it whatsoever. We do not trust ourselves. So we set boundaries early. We honor them always, and we revisit them regularly. This is what you do in a relationship. J.D. Greer, he said it so well. If you don't have any parameters in your relationship, this is a great place to start. He said these four things. Do nothing in the dark, nothing below the chin, nothing horizontal, and nothing that lasts longer than 5 seconds. I'll say it again because some of you need to write it down. Do nothing in the dark, nothing below the chin, nothing horizontal, and nothing that lasts longer than 5 seconds. But it's only 5 seconds. Listen, I know you don't think he's creative, but he can get real creative in 5 seconds, all right? Like, you make sure to set parameters in place because a man without self-control is like a city broken into and left without walls. Like, would you move into a city pillaged of all of its resources and left totally defenseless? No, you wouldn't do that. This is not the way that we would try to take care of ourselves. So why would you expect him or her to move into your relationship and expect to be taken care of? Like, this isn't the way that we engage. The goal in our relationships, it's to seek purity, not to get as close to the line as we can. And yet we do this. We do it frequently. But my boyfriend needs a sexual outlet. No, what your boyfriend needs is self-control. No, I'm being serious. Like, Jesus lived a totally single and a totally sinless life for 33 years. Your boyfriend can make it until he so chooses to marry you or move on. He can do it. You be vigilant about protecting yourself and the other person in your relationship. You be a person that has mastered your flesh and is not manipulated by it. It is not tossed to and fro by every temptation that comes your direction. No, you don't be that type of person. You be someone that throws your shoulders back and lifts your head high and chooses to enter the fray in godly strength, knowing full well that no temptation has overcome you that is uncommon to man. This is how we engage any temptation that enters into a relationship. And the reason we do is because it's that type of person, that kind of man, that kind of woman, that will ultimately be able to uphold the last principle we have, which is you don't be reckless, you do be respectful. Don't be reckless, but do be respectful. Romans 12:10, love one another with brotherly affection. That's an idea of respect. Outdo one another in showing honor. Matthew 7:12, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Listen, your significant other, boyfriend, girlfriend, does not belong to you. They're not your property. They are totally independent of you. You do not control them, manipulate them, coerce them into doing anything at all. This is not the way that we engage in a relationship because that person is not yours, but they will be somebody's one day. They will one day stand at an altar before God and family, and they will commit to belong to another person. But until that time, we are in a season of assessment, not a season of attachment. That's the difference in dating and marriage. But they are not yours, and they will not be until the hard fact that you have stood before God and family, and you have committed to love them from yourself till death do you part. And so until that time, honor them. Respect them. Don't be reckless with them. You do it as well as you can. You honor them to the best of your ability. and you trust the Lord along the way. The background on my phone, the photo that serves as the backdrop, is a picture of this for me. It's the reason why I keep it close. It's because I want to be frequently reminded that in my marriage, in my relationship, there's mutual honor and common trust in God. The photo, it's a picture of me at the biggest speaking event I've ever been a part of. When the stakes had never been higher, like when the crowd was big and the pressure was high and all of the weight of the moment was really heavy. Like it's this picture of, man, I felt totally overwhelmed and in need of God. And so I'm seeking him and I'm trusting him. And right on the heels of me, on her knees too, with her hand on my back, praying to the Lord, honoring me, and trusting God with our lives as my wife. This is a picture of what I want for you. I want you to have someone that will do everything in their power to honor you, to respect you, while simultaneously trusting God for as long as he leads you forward. That may not be forever, but it should be for always, so long as we have together. You want someone that respects you. And you want to respect them. Like, that's someone's husband, man. That's someone's wife. But well beyond that, that is God's daughter. Like, God's son you're dealing with. That's the greatest reason for respect in a relationship. Is no, you're not mine, but you are his. You have an intrinsic dignity because you're made in his image. But even more than just that, like, you're important. Like, God, he saw you so important that he knit you together exactly as you are, and he wrote out all the days of your life. That's how important you are to God. But you're not just important, like, you're valuable. Like, so valuable to the point that God would send his only son to seek and to save you out of the clutches of your sin, to bring you back to himself. You're so valuable, but you're not just that. Like, you're dignified. Like, God didn't just save you and send you on your way. No, he saved you and he secured you for himself. Like, he brought you into his family. He called you son and daughter. Not just forgiven sinner. No, he made you one of his own. This is how God looks upon the people whom we date. He sees them as that's so important and so valuable and so dignified. And so we should do the same. When we engage with people, we should treat them in such a way that it leaves them better at the end of our time with them than we first found them at the beginning. And the reason we do that is because that's what Christ has done for us. He found us in a helpless and hopeless estate. But he's left us so much better. We do the same thing. We find people where they are, and the product of them dating us leads them to a place where they're better off because of it. This is how Christ has loved us. So this is how we should love one another. Date like this, not just because it'll give you a fulfilling connection, but it'll lead you to remember that connection with a holy, transcendent, perfect God that would seek and save even you when you weren't deserving of it. Let me pray for us. Jesus, we acknowledge, like, we're so much better off because you entered into our story, because you searched and sought us out. Any person that's placed their faith in you, they're better off because of you. They've been loosened from the shackles of sin, set free of the ways of shame, and been invited into something the likes of which they never would have found on their own. You're so good for that, God. And so we want to love other people with the same kind of love. And God, we specifically want to do it in romantic relationships, Lord. Like, we want to engage with guys we're interested in, girls we're interested in such a way that just leaves them better than we found them. In such a way, God, that prompts them to love you more, that honors them with dignity, and ultimately, God, encourages their soul. Would you help this to be true for us? If there's any here that have heard of a love like this and you're like, man, I've never received a love like that, then you need to know that kind of love is on the table for you tonight. That, man, your worst days are always behind you once you've placed your faith in Jesus and you walk forward with him forever. And so for some of you tonight, like, you've not placed your faith in Jesus, and yet tonight is going to be your last worst day. And tomorrow will be better. And the day after will be better. And the day after will be better. Not because your circumstances accord with success or prosperity in any way whatsoever, but because the days ahead of you will accord with greater proximity, nearness to the God of the universe. If you want for that, a love like this, then you need only say, Jesus, I repent of my sin. I am broken and bruised. I do things I know that I should not do. And I cannot clean myself up alone. And yet you can make me clean. You can wash my sins away and make me whole again. Would you do that? Would you do it? I place my faith in you, my Lord, my Savior, and love of my life. Others of you, something resonated tonight, not because of delivery, but because of the Spirit. Act on it. Respond in conviction. Pray with someone down front or in the cross aisles if you need to. Stand and sing in gratitude to a God that loves. Or maybe you just need to grab someone and process. And maybe you're here and you're in a relationship and you need to just take your guy, take your girl and say, man, we've been off, but I want us to get right. The space is yours to do with as you wish. But God, we follow your promptings wherever they lead. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.